moment, Father. We need you so much. And we thank you that your presence is here with us this morning. We thank you for bringing us here to your church, to your sanctuary, to worship you together with our fellow brothers and sisters. And we have the opportunity to do so in freedom. We just pray that we would not take it for granted. We thank you so much for the beautiful music that we heard this morning, the word that is coming for all the different instruments, and that it brings our hearts up to you, it lifts us up to you, and worships you to you. And we just thank you and praise you for this wonderful experience to worship you this morning. There are so many prayer requests and praises that have come up regarding health. We thank you and praise you for the health of our members this morning and our visitors and our family members and our co-workers. We just thank you for answered prayer, for bringing us here this morning in spite of the health issues that we have. We pray for our family members, our co-workers, our friends, our community members that have health issues. We pray for ourselves as well. And we just ask that you would continue to lead and guide, to be the healing hand on each and every person, and that you would heal us, not just physically, but spiritually, and that you would draw us into a closer relationship with you. We talked about happy endings this morning at Sabbath school, and that truly our happy ending is when we get to know you, when we know you truly, and how loving you are. We just pray for our revival series that's starting this evening and really starting for us this morning. We just pray for our speaker, Pastor Albury, as he brings your message to us and lights a fire in our hearts. I pray for your Holy Spirit to come upon each and every one of us, and that you would come upon this community as well and draw the people that are our neighbors around here to this place, that we would be a light and beacon to the community for you, that those around us may know who you are, and that we may be drawn closer to you as well. And so I pray for the presence of guidance and mercy. We all want to be ready for you to come. That is the prayer in our hearts, and we want those around us to be ready as well. So put your love and your zeal in our hearts to show others who you are. These things we ask in precious and precious.
Does it sound?
There it is.
Okay.
Good morning,
everyone.
Good morning.
All these beautiful faces. Hello. Hello there. Hi. Can I shake your hand? Very lovely to meet you. You all are so well dressed. Okay. I have to ask you a question before I start. Who here is in third grade? Anyone in third grade? I see one third grader. What grade are you in? You're in fourth grade? You're in third grade? Okay, who's in like first and second grade? You're what grade? First grader, okay. So we got some knowledgeable people up in here.
Good.
Some educated people.
Good.
Hi, what's your name? What's your name? People over here. They have clearly gone to several years of schooling. So I'm sure you're aware of what caterpillars are. You don't know what a caterpillar is? That is exactly the correct answer. What's up, Evelyn? Okay, well, she'll tell you later. Alright, so Pele just told us, Pele being the educated young man, he has told us that caterpillars are things that turn into butterflies. You're so right, sir. Well, once upon a time, now we're going to move away from science, because science is boring. I'm just kidding. No, that's a very bad lesson to teach. Anyway, we're going to move away from science. We're going to go to a story about a caterpillar, and her name is Susan. Yes, she's a very refined woman. Susan, being the caterpillar she was always looking forward to being a butterfly. All she wanted to be in her life was a butterfly. All she thought about, it consumed her day and night. She thought towards it, this is my goal. I'm going to be a butterfly. I am going to meet that goal. I'm going to do whatever it takes. I'm going to eat all the leaves. I'm going to destroy every garden I need to become a butterfly. And so she did. So she worked hard to get to that place. But the problem Susan had was that each day she wasn't happy as a caterpillar. She wasn't happy being a caterpillar because all she wanted to be was a butterfly. And so all she thought about was, when I'm a butterfly, I'm going to be happy. When I get to this point, this is when I will be happy. Do you understand? So she was very depressed as a caterpillar. So all she thought about was, I'm going to be a butterfly. And then when that happens, all my dreams will come true. And so one day, after, the necessary procedures, there's like a cocoon, we're going to skip that part. She does that. She comes out of it, she's a butterfly. And Susan is looking back and thinking, aren't I supposed to be happy now? Isn't this the point where I am completely fulfilled in my life? Isn't this what I've been looking for? Don't I want to be a butterfly? I'm a butterfly. Shouldn't I be happy? So, here's Susan's problem. Susan was so sure that this one thing would make her happy, when in fact, happiness comes from within you. Happiness comes from your family, and happiness comes from your security in knowing that you have a Heavenly Father that loves you. So if Susan had just stopped and thought, I'm a caterpillar, it's all good, maybe she would have been more content when she became a butterfly. Maybe all her life, all the stages of her life would have been happy. And you guys are so young. You're in stage one. This is the time to, enjoy life and just be happy with who you are and happy with the people around you. Love your parents. Give everyone a hug and to be nice and all the good stuff, all the good things. Okay. Thank you for paying attention. You are all very, very well behaved. Good job, parents. Alright. See you.
found in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 1. Oh, sorry. Chapter 1, verse 26 and 27. So if you have your Bible, copy it with me. I will read it. It says, Genesis 1, 26, and God said, "Let us make man in our image, our likeness, and let them have dominion over the beasts of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created in that.
Thank you. Sabbath Church.
Sabbath. Sabbath.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Beautiful music, renditions in this service today. Now I know I'm going to do a duet in the future with our dear pastor, Brother Michael. And we may end up doing that this week, so you don't want to miss out.
Amen.
Oh, brothers and sisters, it is a joy to be here in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Even a greater excitement just to know that it was just a year ago that I had the privilege to be here and worship with you. Time surely does fly.
Amen.
But praise the Lord, He has kept you and I in good keeping. And that we have another day of life where we can glorify His name. This morning, it's a privilege to be here, and I want to extend the gratitude for the invitation to Pastor Langley and Pastor Gomez. If you don't know, Pastor Gomez and I are in the pulpit spot today. And so he is down in the Utica International Church for the first time. Let us continue to pray for him. Let us continue to pray for this series, the covenant series. All those that have been a part of the implementation, the planning, the comings together for this weekly program and the one that I wish I could be in two places at one time. But that omnipresence only belongs to God. We have heard down below. They have a program this week for the children. Amen?
Amen.
So we have no excuses. If you need someone to come on out and you want to have a good word from the Lord and you need someone to watch your kids, what better place than downstairs where they too can receive a word? Amen?
Amen.
Come on out this week. The weather is beautiful. Love our children. The wind is just right. We put on our apparel. Not the favorite ones, just enough ones where you can, you know, snuggle and drink some hot chocolate. Let's do it here. Amen.
Amen.
This week the Lord has a word for us. A transformative word, nonetheless, because I believe in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Who's got the power? God's got the power. Don't go around saying, I've got the power. Only way for me to have the power is God working in me. And we don't know when that time is, the word says, but we must continue to pray. And so, brothers, prayer is what we need. Prayer is what we'll do in order that the Holy Spirit can reign His power in this place and we can be spirit-filled. Amen?
Amen.
But before we continue, I want to say it is a privilege to have my wife here. My son, the last time I came, they were not able to join, but there they are, and I am sure in a few moments my son will make his presence known, and then you will know why they call him mine. In all seriousness, let's pay homage to our Lord and Savior as we bow our heads in prayer. A kind and loving heavenly Father. You, O God, are God alone. There is none. Thank you, God, for waking us up this morning. Thank you for giving us this day. Sending your Son, Jesus Christ, in order that we can claim this day that He has ours. For your mercies are good to us. Forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us and remove our transgressions, O God. Remove our sinful thoughts and impurities, anything that can stand between me and the sin. Lord, Heavenly Father, let nothing come between us and thee in this hour. Allow your Holy Spirit to pour in a double portion in order that we can be here filled. And I say to you, that at the end of the day, all the people will give you the praise and honor. They see not me, they hear not me. Let them see you. And let them hear your voice. Let your word out. Bless this service. Bless this word. And all the way down, let me get some to it. In Jesus' name. Amen. The book of Genesis, chapter 1. Verse 26 and 27 is our Elder Mel sung the read. I will read again in your hearing from the NIV version. Forgive me for the Lord. That's the one I chose to read. Verse 26 says, and God said, let us make what? Man in our image. After our life. Let him have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his what? In the image of God created him. Male and what? Female. Created he. Servant, the word entitled this morning is entitled The Image. The Image. This week we have the opportunity to look closer at what a covenant means. For adults, in some way or the other, we've crossed paths between some form of covenant, agreement, binding contract. The Hebrew word for covenant is translated berit, meaning literally a pact or a treaty. It is one of the most frequently used words in Hebrew scriptures. Actually, it appears 270 times and is one of scripture's most important concepts. The Bible understands covenant from two different perspectives. First, the unconditional or eternal covenant known as Berit Olam between Yahweh and Israel / Judah presumes that the covenant can never be broken. Although, listen, it does allow for divine judgment. Stay with me. The conditional covenant, however, means that the covenant might be broken if the people fail to comply with the divine will, but even conditional formulations of the covenant, for example, such as Deuteronomy chapters 28 to 30, for those that know their scripture and know everything that it says in Leviticus and Deuteronomy about covenants, that the covenant will be restored when Israel repents. Both understandings refer to the same covenant between Yahweh and Israel, but individual texts portray this covenant from different and various perspectives. This week, we will be able to amplify, expose a little bit more throughout the week what a covenant actually is. More and more that word will come light and bring meaning to us. Most important spiritually. That's why tonight, let me take this time, Sister Mars, to project. This evening, we don't want to miss out at 7 p.m. Sermon entitled, A Perpetual Sign. A Perpetual Sign. But in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, the key focus here is God and image. Hebrew translates, and God created man in his own image. Literally, the translation is Elohim bara Adam tzelem. Elohim, we've got to understand that who's doing the creating? God. Stay with me. Elohim must always be recognized and homage must be given to, because you know Elohim is literally translated as strength and power. So you know that the Almighty Powerful One had to put something inside of you to make you who you are. Come back. Bara, the word Hebrew bara, remember this word, is the idea of creating. It's an idea of creating and is an abstract thought that is formed in Hebrew thought. You have to understand Hebrew thought, the idea of bara, creating, was abstract. The concrete understanding, however, if we expose that Hebrew word create bara, can be seen in scriptures like 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 29, where he says and he talks about the fattening. How is that? You can go about fattening yourself. This is an extension, however. But the reason I want to use this extension of bara is that you don't get confused, because in the beginning we spoke about two different perspectives now. And we'll curve back on that at the end of this week in a key asking form. However, bara means to be filled up. To be filled up. Fat. To be filled up. When we focus on the scripture and we go deeper, we know that man is Adam. God created man, Adam. And we go in Tessaline, because today it's all about the Tessaline. Remember it, brothers and sisters. It is literally translated as a shadow. A shadow, which is the outline or representation of the outline or representation of the original. So when we're talking about the original Dandata, I'm talking about Jesus. God created man in his own image. When we read, and God created man in his own image, our minds become considered. Typically tends to form a mental picture of what we look like. And then we attribute this picture to God himself. In Hebrews minds, it is not the appearance of something that the conscious trait, that the constant trait of, that actually is function. It's function. The image is not an appearance, but it's a what? A function. God created man for the sole purpose to function for something. This passage is not implying a picture of a man or God, but their function. Through the Hebrew words of this text, we see that God had placed within man a shadow or representation of his own function, goal, purpose, thoughts, and etc. That's why we know that an image can be reflected in the form of Isaiah chapter 1, 55, verse 8 and 1. And it says, "For I know your thoughts, know which shall be my thoughts, and my ways." Twice, what high is the heavens upon the earth? so shall your faults and your ways. Come on.
Now, I didn't paraphrase that,
but you get the idea. It is a function. It is our own responsibility to live our lives
as representatives of God's purposes, acting in the same manner as He did.
Too many times we allow society to dictate what our image should be. Have you ever seen a child who's on the verge and cusp of grasping his first thesis? It's a lot of boo-boos and ga-gas. He's making sense to himself. But lo and behold, you've got to catch yourself, because a child's brain is like a sponge. And if you say the wrong thing and you do the wrong thing, they will literally enact what you do and say what you do. Did you think 3-year-olds do not know how to curse? The society, sin, the world that we live in, children's minds like sponges are being tainted and distorted, reflecting and shadowing images that they see from television, that they hear from music, that they see adults and parents enact themselves who are not. And I say, represent. An image is a funny thing, brothers and sisters. Society tells you that in the morning, you've got to make sure you look good before you step out. Yes, brothers and sisters, you can't apply or expect to get that job or promotion you look for if you don't take care of yourself. Grooming is one discussion. Vanity is another. There are some folks in here, brothers and sisters, they spend so much time looking in the mirror. Constantly wondering if they can alter any defects. The more you look at yourselves in the mirror, you know what you want to see, right? Defects. Why do you think you keep looking? If you are sure of yourself, listen now, because when we talk about image, we do have to focus on dignity. We will get to that today. The reason we look at ourselves is because of insecurity. Satan is constantly trying to pour into your mind, you ain't good enough. You don't look good enough. You'll never be good enough. Nothing you do will change who you are. You ain't nothing. And then God is trying to tell you, listen, I created you in my image. He ain't saying that He's just creating you. He's barraging you. He's filling you up. Because if we get deeper and deeper into this series, and we begin to understand that transformation begins within and not without, God does not focus on the appearance, but the function. Brothers and sisters, I can sing that song. He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. It only took Him a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun, the earth, Jupiter, and Mars. And He ain't done with you. Because as long as you're willing, as long as you're willing and He's able, and you want to be a representative of God, you may not know when, you may not know how, but He'll do it again and He'll fill you up. That bara is not something to be taken out. The devil is good at convincing and enticing God's children to destroy in a moment's notice the reputation that God is spending a lifetime to build.
Did you hear me?